Good morning, everyone, and welcome to you all from King Church International here in Windsor and in Robertson, South Africa, and from many different places around the world.
Really is a great blessing to join together in this way with so many of you, and we're very happy to have had such encouraging feedback of how these services have been a help and challenge and inspiration to you. We also thank you for your prayers, and we assure you that we're also praying for you and that these services will bless many people.
Yes, in times of change and uncertainty, it is so important to keep focused on Jesus Christ and to do all we can to build the church and spread the good news of the kingdom of God. As we are learning in our new series, this is a time that we can overcome every challenger, and also that we can face with the help of the Holy Spirit.
In this time of pandemic, I have been reminded of two scriptures in particular. They keep coming back to me. One is from Hebrews chapter 12 and 27 and 28, and it says there that everything that can be shaken will be shaken, and many things that we know and we thought were unshakable, they're being shaken, so that what cannot be shaken will remain, and that is the unchangeable kingdom of God. The other passage that has come to me is one that's probably familiar to many of you, and that's from Isaiah chapter 60, verses 1 to 3. Arise and shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord rises upon you. See, darkness covers the earth, thick darkness is over the peoples, but the Lord rises on you, and his glory appears over you. Nations will come to your light, and kings and rulers to the brightness of your dawn.
Today we are going to learn more of how to win in life. Please open your hearts and get ready to receive a very special word. But first, let's pray. Thank you, Heavenly Father. We welcome your presence, Holy Spirit, and we are so thankful with you, because we can lead by faith, not by fear, Lord. Thank you for your great love. Thank you for every teaching you are giving to us, for every guidance through your word and through your Holy Spirit. We pray today, Lord, for a new understanding from your word, and also from new fire from the Holy Spirit, because we need more your presence every day, Lord. We are open in our hearts and in our mind to receive more from you. And we pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Well, we wish we could give you a hug if you're with someone there, the family. Give each other a hug. If you're on your own, know that you're part of the family of God. Let's worship the Lord together right now.
Causes us to triumph in his name. Thanks be to God who always causes us to win. Yeah. Thanks be to God who always causes us to triumph in his name. Thanks be to God. Thanks be to God. Thanks be to God who always causes Whoa!
reading from Revelation chapter 12, verses 10 to 11.
Then I heard a loud voice in heaven say, "Now have come the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Messiah. For the accuser of our brothers and sisters, who accuses them before our God day and night, has been hurled down.
They triumphed over him by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. They did not love their lives so much as to shrink from death."
A reading from Ephesians 1, verse 7. In him we have redemption, through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace.
1 Peter 1, verse 18 to 21. For you know that it was not with perishable things, such as silver or gold, that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your ancestors, but with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect.
He was chosen before the creation of the world, but was revealed in these last times for your sake. Through him, you believe in God, who raised him from the dead and glorified him, and so your faith and hope are in God.
Hebrews 9, verse 27 to 28. Just as people are destined to die once, and after that to face judgment, so Christ was sacrificed once to take away the sins of many. He will appear a second time, not to bear sin, but to bring salvation to those who are waiting for him.
Hebrews 10, 19 to 22. Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the most holy places by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way open for us through the curtain, that is his body, and since we have a great priest over the house of God,
let us draw near God with sincere heart and with full assurance that faith brings, having our heart sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience, and having our bodies washed with pure water.
Exodus 12, verses 12 and 13. On that same night I will pass through Egypt and strike down every firstborn of both people and animals, and I will bring judgment on all the gods of Egypt. I am the Lord. The blood will be a sign for you on the houses where you are, and when I see the blood I will pass over you. No destructive plague will touch you when I strike Egypt.
A reading from Hebrews 4, verse 16. Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need.
Hi, I'm Melody, and this week we will be continuing to look at how we win in life by discovering the power of the blood of Jesus. This teaching is foundational to Christianity, even though some people don't like to hear about it. The Apostle Paul said, "We preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles, but to those whom God has called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God." Every time you see a powerful Christian revival somewhere, someone has discovered a new revelation of the power of the blood of Jesus. Many teachers, preachers, and hymn writers have focused on the power of the blood. Hymns that mention the blood offends the sensibilities of many 21st century singers, and as a result causes them to reject any hymn that mentions the blood. However, the truth of these hymns are powerful. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. William Cowper, a renowned 18th century English poet, wrote hymns about the blood of Jesus that freed him from his depression. He and John Newton wrote a series of hymns called the Olney Hymns, which included Amazing Grace. Cowper wrote, "There is a fountain filled with blood, drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and sinners plunged beneath that flood lose all their guilty stains." We are going to look at three examples of people who have taught about the power of the blood of Jesus
and we will hear some quotes from various Christian preachers in a moment. Myself and my husband began to have a new revelation of the power of the blood when we realised our daughter's heart was not functioning properly and she was not able to receive oxygen to the lungs. She needed open heart bypass surgery at 3 months old, whilst also battling a lung infection and hours away from brain damage. We knew that we could only overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. We learned that we needed to confess with our mouth, and through God's divine mercy, we conquered the miracle for grace by grace. We declared the word that this sickness will not end in death, but would be for the glory of God. We received a call from Pastor Cesar, and he challenged us to push through for the miracle. As he declared the blood of Jesus over Grace in the hospital, and my father, Pastor Wes, anointed her with oil, we could see her whole composure changed. After we left her on the physician's table and came to a small lonely room to wait, we turned on the TV to find a choir singing Amazing Grace. We knew that the great physician was fighting her battles. Today she is fit and well and loves to run. Let's now look at three stories.
The 18th century revival of John Wesley, Whitfield and others was powerful, but the movement exploded in its numbers and influence in the 19th century and laid the foundations of the global Holy Spirit movement in the 20th and 21st centuries. It was the biblical quality of the teaching and preaching that gave the movement its momentum, with its moral and spiritual impact continuing to this day. J.C. Ryle, in his famous book, 18th Century Christian Leaders, outlines several characteristics about how these reformers' preaching changed the history of darkest England. They preached everywhere and anywhere that people could be found. They preached simply, so everyone could understand the message. And they preached fervently and directly, with faith, conviction, and fire. They believed that you must speak from the heart if you want to speak to the heart. They taught the sufficiency and supremacy of the Holy Scripture and constantly taught the total corruption of human nature. They told people plainly that they were dead and must be made alive again, that they were guilty, lost, helpless, hopeless, and in imminent danger of eternal ruin. However, they taught that Christ's death on the cross was the only satisfaction for man's sin. When Christ died, he died as our substitute, the just for the unjust. But the one subject above all others concerning Christ which they delighted to dwell on was the atoning blood which Jesus Christ shed on the cross. They taught the doctrine of justification by faith. It was by grace that we were created, but our own work alone cannot atone for all our sin, and therefore we only find favour with God through grace. This preaching was not fashionable in political circles and changed the lives of some of the hardest people in society. When they faithfully preached the blood of Jesus, the Holy Spirit worked faithfully through them.
Andrew Murray was an outstanding South African Christian teacher, preacher, and writer, described as a forerunner of Pentecostalism. He was the son of a very godly man of the same name, his father, Andrew Murray Sr., who prayed for a revival in South Africa every Friday evening for 36 years. In 1860, a great revival started in the Western Cape. Murray's preaching in Worcester spread through the whole town and surrounding areas. It started with the brown farm workers, spread throughout the Cape, and became internationally known. Prayer meetings overflowed, people's lives were changed, and churches had to be extended to accommodate the growing numbers. One of the strongest foundations to impact this revival was Andrew's preaching on the power of the blood of Jesus. From the beginning to the end of Scripture, from the closing of the gates of Eden to the opening of the gates of heavenly Zion, there runs through Scripture a golden thread. It is the blood that unites the beginning and the end, that gloriously restores what sin had destroyed. He says, "Let us take time and trouble to learn the full blessing and the power of that blood." The blood of Jesus is the greatest mystery of eternity, the deepest mystery of divine wisdom. Let us not imagine that we can easily grasp its meaning. The blood must have the same place in our hearts that it has with God. We can rely on the Lord Jesus to reveal us the power of His blood. It is by the confident trust in Him that the blessing obtained by the blood become ours. A restoration of this teaching on the blood of Jesus is going to fuel a greater revival that is going to take place in the Western Cape and in South Africa.
Derek Prince was an outstanding teacher on the power of the blood of Jesus and has had a personal impact of the life and teaching of Pastor Cesar Castellanos. Educated at Eton and Cambridge, he served in the British Army in World War II, where he encountered the power of God's Word. He is the author of 60 books and hundreds of audio and video messages, many of which have been translated and published in more than 60 languages. He was himself miraculously healed of an incurable skin disease and cancer. In the early years of his ministry, he suffered from intense depression that would overcome him and rest upon him like a dark cloud. Even though he prayed and he fasted and he knew the scriptures, his condition got worse. God revealed to him that he had a spirit of despair and that the only remedy was the blood of Jesus Christ, for him to receive a garment of praise. The blood of Christ is the visible, eternal evidence of the sacrifice that Jesus made on our behalf. When we come in the name of Jesus, we come with the merits of the blood that he shed on our behalf. He understood the powers of darkness want to afflict people, stop them from knowing Christ, and stop them from serving Christ. Through the cross, we can crucify the desires of the sinful nature, but the remedy to wrong spirits in our life is the blood of Jesus Christ. When we repent and renounce a spirit of pride, rebellion, witchcraft, fear, rejection, and depression through the power of the blood of Jesus, we can be set free. Prince explains the theology of the divine exchange that took place on the cross, mentioned in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 14, that by one offering he has perfected forever those who are being sanctified.
All through history, great teachers and preachers have emphasized the power of the blood of Jesus. Charles Spurgeon, known as the Prince of Preachers, admitted to struggling with depression, but taught how he overcame through the peace-speaking blood of Jesus.
He said, "Atonement by the blood of Jesus is not an arm of Christian truth, it is the heart of it." He also said, "There are some preachers who cannot or do not preach about the blood of Jesus Christ, and I have one thing to say to you concerning them. Never go hear them. A ministry that has not the blood in it is lifeless."
There may be some sins of which man cannot speak, Spurgeon says, but there is no sin which the blood of Christ cannot wash away. Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones says there is far too much easy familiarity with the Most High. Thank God we can come into His presence with holy boldness through the blood of Christ, but that should never lessen our reverence and godly fear. And Leon Morris says, "We have been made close to God through His blood, for His blood has secured an eternal redemption for us and has purified our hearts, granting us confident entry into the very holiest of places, the divine presence itself."
Benny Hinn said, "We had nothing to do with earning our salvation. We have nothing to do with keeping it. Every time we say there is something I must do, God says I've done it. Mm-hmm. All you need to do is accept it. Religion says do, Jesus says done. When Jesus shed his blood on the cross, he said it is finished. He didn't say to be continued."
Mahesh Chavda, a senior pastor and international evangelist, was at a crusade in Africa and he had a revelation of how one drop of the blood of Jesus can destroy the kingdom of Satan. 800 sorcerers attended a gathering of around 150,000 people. These sorcerers had great demonic power and terrified the people and the meeting leaders. Afraid that the crowd would erupt in anarchy and fear as thousands of demons began manifesting, Chavda declared, "In the name of Jesus and through his blood, I command you to stop." The entire place became absolutely quiet. And later, 25,000 people gave their lives to Christ. Sick bodies were healed and blind eyes were opened. And Chavda learned that every demon has to bow when we walk in the revelation of the blood.
So this is a topic we all need to understand and come to a greater level of revelation. I've been listening to a song recently called Victory in Jesus. I heard an old story, how a savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory. We are so grateful for Pastor Cesar's teaching on the blood of Jesus all around the world. And it is my great privilege to introduce Pastor Cesar as our guest speaker today.
Hola, Pastor Wes, Pastora Adriana, y a toda la congregación, un cordial saludo deseándoles las más ricas bendiciones de Dios en Cristo Jesús. Gracias, Pastor Wes, por la oportunidad que me da de compartir en este día la palabra del Señor. Y bueno, sabemos que tenemos muchos desafíos por delante, pero con la ayuda del Señor y entendiendo lo que Él hizo por nosotros, lo vamos a conquistar. We are going to conquer everything in a supernatural manner. There is a scripture that is found in the book of Revelation, chapter 12 and verse 11. It says, and they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they did not love their lives to the death.
Permítame empezar este momento con una palabra de oración. Padre, en este momento,
Father,
pido que envíes una bendición muy poderosa sobre todas estas personas que en este momento están participando de esta enseñanza. Que tú corras el velo para que todos puedan entender la riqueza que hay en cada uno de los derramamientos de tu sangre.
That you shed. Thank you, Jesus, because we know that this is the time where you are going to be glorified through your church. We love you, God, in Christ Jesus. Amen. Today I'd like to share a message called The Power of the Blood of Jesus. It's so interesting that in the book of Revelation, the Word of God speaks of a great battle in the kingdom of heaven. Michael and his angels, they fought against the dragon and his angels. And then it says that they, the demonic powers, were not able to prevail because Michael and his angels cast them out. But the credit is not being given to Michael and the angels, but to the believers. It says, and they have overcome, referring to us Christians, by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they did not love their lives to the death. Notice that it is mentioning three aspects of the victory that believers have when we face the dragon, when we face the serpent of old, the devil and Satan. And Michael, he is simply working in directly connected with the Church of Jesus, and that is why it's so important for us to become experts in getting to know the power that is in the blood of Jesus. You know, when I started my Christian life, the first few years, all I knew about the blood was to say, there's power in the blood of Jesus, but praise God, as time passed, God removed the veil, and He gave me great revelation about the great wealth that is found in every one of Jesus' bloodsheds. We need to remember that Jesus, in seven different occasions, He shed blood. And the first time that Jesus shed blood, it happened on the saddest night. It was at the Garden of Gethsemane. Jesus knew that Judas was going to betray Him. And that is why He celebrated the Passover with His disciples. And in the midst of that gathering, while they were having fellowship, He said, "Assuredly, I say to you, one of you who eats with Me will betray Me." And they all began to wonder who it could be. Jesus answered, "It is he to whom I shall give a piece of bread." And Jesus took bread and dipped it in the wine, and He gave it to Judas. Immediately after that, Judas, he ate the bread, and Satan entered him. Now, we need to remember, Paul the Apostle said, "For no one is to participate in an unworthy manner, because he eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this reason, many are sick and weak among you, and many sleep." As soon as Judas ate the bread, Satan entered him, and then Jesus said to him, "What you do, do quickly." That is when Judas went out, and he was determined to betray
his teacher. And the Lord himself, he went with his disciples to the garden at Gethsemane. And it was amazing because that night, every one of them, they were sleepy, they were tired. The three that were always closest to Jesus, they also fell asleep. And Jesus had to wake them up and he said, "Could you not watch with me 1 hour?" But that was the night of struggle. It was a night of battle for Jesus. But while he was there in the garden in Gethsemane, completely lonely, where it was just the Lord and the Father, it says, and being in agony, he prayed more earnestly. Then his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down to the ground. Notice how it is speaking of Jesus. In the moment of anguish, Jesus began to sweat blood. It says, like great drops of blood falling down to the ground. That was perhaps the most difficult night for Jesus. And I say it was the most difficult because Jesus, he had never hesitated about the mission that the Father had entrusted him. He was always willing. He knew what he was going to do. But that night, Jesus had a vision where he saw a cup. And when he saw that cup, Jesus, he was so shaken. Remember that Jesus, apart from being the Son of God, he has been the wisest man who has ever stepped on this earth. He never contaminated his life with anything. He was always submitted to the will of the Father. But when Jesus was at the garden, it's like the veil was open and he was able to see everything that was in that cup. And that is why he wanted to reject it, because he could see all the filth and he could see all the terrible things of human's sin. And that is when Jesus was shaken and he prayed to the Father. He said, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Could you imagine how the angels felt in that moment? Could you imagine how the kingdom of heaven must have felt in the moment in which Jesus was about to finish his race towards redemption? And that is when he cried out from the bottom of his heart, Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. I think that heaven, all of heaven must have come to a halt. I think the angels must have looked at each other and they were wondering, and if Jesus refuses to experience this suffering, who could do it? And I think that they probably searched all over the earth and the heavens and they couldn't find any other person that could take the place that Jesus was about to take for us. And that's why I think that heaven must have come to a halt for a moment. Now, I don't know for how long, but I think it did come to a halt when Jesus said that. When those words came out of his mouth, heaven came to a standstill. But, oh, what a relief when Jesus continued speaking and said, nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. Oh, all of heaven must have felt great ease. That is when Jesus accepted to give his life as an offering for redemption. And when he made that decision, it brought something new to him. He felt strength and he felt determined. He determined to go to the end, regardless of what the outcome might be. And I want to tell you, redemption was conquered in that garden. That first bloodshed, it was crucial. And I'm so grateful to God that Jesus took that courage and strength, and Jesus determined to keep on moving to the end so as to bring redemption to mankind. Immediately, the Lord, he got up
And he was determined. And it's interesting to me, as I saw the movie, The Passion of Christ, it shows us the serpent roaming around Jesus. But when Jesus made the decision to carry out redemption, he got up and Jesus lifted his foot and crushed the head of the serpent. That was the moment where the Lord conquered. He conquered 90% of the redemption of humanity. And then when Jesus went to look for his disciples, every single one of you were asleep. And he said, Peter, could you not watch with me for an hour? But that night, everything was so difficult. Everything was so hard. Why? Because it was a battle. It was Jesus' battle for us. You see, every single one of us, we have to go through a similar moment in our lives. And that moment is when we feel like everything is shutting down on us, where we feel that there is not a light of hope for us, whether it be financially or emotionally in any area. And that is the moment where we need to refuge in the Lord and where we fight our battle. And then we could truly say, that is our Gethsemane. You know, it's a night of prayer. For Jacob, it was at Peniel, where he decided to cling to the angel and said, I will not let you go unless you bless me. And that night, Jesus, he did not let go of the Father. He trusted in him. He relied on him, and he determined to endure to the end. Now, we know what was in the cup. It was all kinds of filth of the sin of men in that cup. Jesus knew that by drinking that cup, he would have to face hell. But he did it. But the Lord himself, he declared, for you will not leave my soul in Sheol, nor will you allow your Holy One to see corruption. Jesus knew that after death, he was going to have to face hell. But he overcame. And why did Jesus overcome? Because the heart of Jesus was always pure and holy. And he always was set aside for God, and he always kept his spiritual authority. That is why hell was not able to overcome him, because before Jesus did it, Jesus had already overcome the prince of hell, and hell, it had to stand down. Satan was not a place for Jesus, nor a place for believers, but it ended up being a place for the traitor, whose name is devil and Satan. And that is why it says, and the smoke of their torment ascends forever and ever, not only for the devil, but for all those who allow themselves to be seduced by him. Jesus rose up in triumph, in victory. That was the result of his first bloodshed, and that opened the door for believers to take hold of every one of the bloodsheds of Jesus. Now, I'd like to ask you, have you truly participated in the blood of Jesus? You see, we have to remember what Revelation says, and they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb. When we understand all the power that is in every one of the bloodsheds of Jesus, I assure you that God is filling us with authority so that we could raise our foot and crush the head of Satan. Now, the question I have for you is, how is your relationship with God? Have you fully surrendered your life to Jesus? If you have not done so, I believe that this is the best moment, the greatest moment for all of us to fully surrender our lives at Jesus' feet. I'd like to invite you to join me in the following prayer. And please place your hand over your heart so that you could enjoy a true repentance and receive God's forgiveness, the forgiveness that God will give each and every one of us. Father, in this moment, I present the lives of every one of your children. And Sovereign Lord, I pray that your blood, the blood that you shed at the Garden of Gethsemane, when you were suffering And when you suffered the cross, I pray that that blood, I pray that it will touch each and every single one of us. Lord, look at all the lives right now, all the people that are turning their hearts back to you, and they are begging for each and every one of your bloodsheds to break the chains of oppression and to remove all darkness and remove every single bondage from their lives. Today, Lord God, we know that your blood, it has all the power to destroy every force of darkness from hell. And Lord, just as Michael and his angels were able to overcome the dragon and his angels, oh Lord, today we take authority now over every adverse force that is operating in the earth, that is operating all around us. And we bind every single one of those spirits of witchcraft. We bind the spirit of Bar Jesus, that spirit that is full of all deceit, that is full of evil, that spirit that operates in the son of the devil, the enemy of all righteousness. Right now, we bind every one of those spirits by the blood of the Lamb of God that was slain. And we bind those spirits by the blood that Jesus shed from his brow at the Garden of Gethsemane. We bind those spirits with the blood that Jesus shed from his back, from his head, from his face, from his hands, from his feet, and from his right side, when they pierced his side with a spear and water and blood came out. With the fullness of the blood of Jesus, we neutralize those demonic powers that were manifested through that spirit of Bar Jesus. And we decree that from this moment on, they shall be blind and they will not see the light of the sun for a time, because they do not cease perverting the straight ways of the Lord. And I pray that the angels will remove those spirits and take them to that place of darkness, those prisons of darkness where they will not see the light of the sun for the time that the Holy Spirit determines. Now, Father, I pray that you open the heavens. I pray that you release your blessing on every one of your children in a supernatural way. Lord, I pray that you bring healing to those who are sick. Bring provision to those who are in need. I pray that you bring restoration to everyone that has been affected in their emotions, in their family. Lord, I pray that you will raise your children as signs of your glory. I pray that you will help them in every step that they take. I pray that you bring a wall of protection all around them, that none of them will fall from your ways. Lord, I pray that you do this in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Amen. And amen. And to every one of you watching, I really want to tell you congratulations, because up to this moment, you have been persevering in the faith. Never allow anyone to sway you away from fellowship with God. Wait until the day in which the Lord gives you his great reward. I tell you, it's worth it to keep our heart for God and to wait on him. I send you greetings and may God bless you.
Jesus bled, died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet. My Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound, drenched in tears. They laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all alone. Son of Heaven rose again. Oh, trampled death, where is your sting? The angels roar for Christ our King. Yeah. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise His name forevermore. For endless days we will sing Your praise. Oh, Lord our God. Shall we turn in robes of white? The blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints with my gaze transfixed on Jesus' face. Praise the name, oh, praise the name, praise His name.
Thank you for joining us today. If you have any prayer requests, please contact us at hello@kcionline.org. If you wish to find out more about our church, please visit our website at kcionline.org. If you wish to stay connected with us, please go to kcionline.org/connect and fill in the form online. If you wish to find out more about giving, please go to kcionline.org/giving. To catch up with any of our services, please go to kcionline.org/podcast or simply download the KCI app on the App Store. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channels at King's Church International and our senior pastors Wes and Adriana Richards. We welcome you to join us again every Sunday at 10 a.m. God bless you.